properly caffeinated. You need more caffeine. So I had dinner last night with a chocolate freak, and it was like a coffee freak. Oh, it was all about chocolate. It was really impressive. And he pulled out a secret stash. Mind blown. I like chocolate, but I was impressed. So anyway, so caffeine up. That's my advice to you. So. My colleague, Emma Sherwood-Forbes, is giving a workshop panel later today. That's going to be good. I needed to give you that shout out. I want to tell a story about my backyard. So, as many of you know, I've been living on a former dairy farm in West Petaluma for the last 6 years, so my life has changed dramatically. But for 28 years, I lived in a 3-2 on the wrong side of the tracks in Menlo Park, in the deep depths of Silicon Valley. And it was this little ranch-style house, and the backyard was all overgrown with ivy, and it was really a kind of an unpleasant place. These just scraggly bushes that took over, and there were little tiny squares and triangles of concrete interspersed with squares of straggly lawn in the front. And I hated this yard. But it had one thing that was just delightful, which is it had this old kidney-shaped 1950s era swimming pool. And it was fun for the kids and the neighbor kids, and on a hot summer afternoon you could dive in, and it was very refreshing. And then a few years ago my wife said, "Honey, we're going to remodel the yard, we're going to landscape it and make it beautiful." And I said, "That is wonderful, I love this, this is a good thing." She says, "Honey, we have to remove the pool to do it." And I said, no, the pool is the only thing I like about the backyard. How can you do that? It's crazy to remove the one wonderful thing. And so we compromised and we removed the pool. my wife hired this brilliant genius artist and landscape designer named Kevin Forrest, who did an artistic installation in our backyard. It's like Sunset Magazine worthy. He calls it Baja Kabuki. And a truly remarkable thing happened. He let light into the corners of the yard. He put in cooking places and sitting places and meeting places and conversation places and monoliths and plants and trees and sculptural elements, and it became the magnet for the neighborhood. Everybody wanted to be there. I wanted to be there. I was in that yard whenever the sun was out. And my wife was out, and the kids were there, and this is when kids were in high school, so it's a sensitive time. Your parents will know, and you will remember, your teenager will remember. So this was the place where everybody gathered. And it just transformed our life and became this wonderful, wonderful place. And it is the metaphor for me in telling the story of this ancient Cherokee phrase, we're kona bozuko, and it means letting go of what you cherish in order to open yourself to something of greater value. And it's an important principle, I think, in the work we do today. A lot of it is because we are often confused about what is valuable to us today, and we get wrapped up in our work, and it's really easy to lose sight. And people ask me what's the most important thing about UX design, and I say it's not a design problem; it's a power struggle. We have had to, I'm changing my talk as right now because I have asserted for many years that we have to fight for our rights and our seat at the table. But what's really interesting is what we're doing is changing somewhat. So now we have a seat at the table, we finally have power, and we're finding that greater responsibility is falling on our shoulders every day. The things that make for success in the technical world are confusing and contradictory, they're counterintuitive. We're constantly struggling with these forces. Many of them are self-imposed. As we know, the cost to make something no longer relates to what we sell, like what we pay for Twitter or Facebook or Snapchat. And so it means that the old business value function, the functionality divided by the price, this doesn't make any sense anymore. It doesn't mean anything. So I have to say, why do managers continue to obsess so much about controlling costs in the world of product development? I don't understand it. I feel like it's incumbent on us to give them a whack upside the head and say, maybe we're not doing the right thing here. So it means that there's a new currency. It's not money, it's attention. And I'm certainly not telling you anything you don't know. The magic for today is to find a big market and satisfy it. And if you do that, if you make people love what you're doing, then they will tell their friends, and that's how you create a success. The network effect is strong. The way you attract attention is through delight. You delight people. And there's still a lot of thought out there that the way you attract attention is through functionality. That's not true. Is many of the most successful products are really thin on the feature list. And delight is a difficult commodity. You know, what is delight? Is sometimes it's doing some ancient thing really well, and sometimes it's doing something new. That's innovation. And but innovation is this obvious word, you know, as we toss it around all the time. And it means, of course, doing things new and different, better and friendlier, or easier to learn than to use. But the challenge is not having ideas, but developing. So the kind of a quote from Scott Berman, who says the debate's not brainstorming ideas, is a grand rattle, a wild goose chase. The thing is that there are really good ideas everywhere. We all have them. The problem is, how do you develop them into products? That's a much more difficult thing. There are too many people. It's really easy to say no to a new idea. All you have to do is just say, how do you know it's going to work? And any creative person says, oh, I'm going to go back to my desk now. So, in order to do this kind of innovation, you have to have a willingness to just do it, to just build it, to make it in the face of that kind of, are you sure, how do you know, kind of resistance. And so this is why I have an axiom I like, which is innovation is in the hands of the hands-on. The idea is that innovation comes from practitioners who make things and build things, and you learn from that. There's so much of industrial management is based on the idea that smart people in the walnut panel corner office are the ones who think up the bright stuff, and then all the workers down on the factory floor merely execute. And that whole paradigm has just been shifted. There's a real conundrum here in the world of this kind of innovative stuff. I've been an entrepreneur all my life, and I know that the only thing that makes stuff real is a kind of a relentless drive to be elbowing people out of the way, say, get out of my way, I'm making something here. And I know that those of you who have any experience with startups have seen that phenomenon of people saying, I'm making, go away. And so it's really important to have that drive. But at the same time, I've been an inventor all my life. And the thing about creating new innovative stuff that attracts people is about being able to say, why do I want that? Why is that of interest to me? Why is it of interest to you? What's going on here? And take a step back and look critically at your own work. And so this, I believe that your ego is what gets stuff built, but your humility is what gets stuff loved. And this is a hard thing to embody in a single mind. There aren't a lot of hard-charging entrepreneurs who have humility, and a lot of the people who have that humility don't have that ego to elbow people out of the way and say, I'm going to build stuff here. But without a doubt, the biggest obstacle to innovation is that innovation looks stupid. Every good idea looks stupid because it's a new idea by definition. And a lot of older ideas that look good, you know, when people are saying, I'm like, well, that's a good idea, that means you're doomed. But when people are going, that's awful, that's stupid, nobody will look, now you're onto something. Because if it's new, it's unfamiliar. It's unfamiliar, people don't like it. Ideas. Or if this woman's selling margaritas on the beach, I mean, better than you. the idea of renting out your house or just randomly meeting strangers by the roadside, these all were really stupid looking ideas. At first, all these, I mean, when I first looked at Minecraft, I said, I love to make things. And I go, everything's in these giant blocks. I don't get it. The truth is, I actually have a long track record of making bad decisions. Who figured out that this would be a toy that would last for 100 years? I certainly remember back in the early days of the personal computer industry when I was telling people, you're going to have a computer. People said, why would I want a computer? It just really looked like a dumb thing. A friend of mine came over to visit me one day, and this was in the 90s, and he said, I've got this idea for a butler on the screen, and you can just ask him questions. And I'll ask him, right? Well, that's a pretty dumb idea, Garrett. And Garrett now flies around in a little fancy airplane. So innovation really looks stupid. George Gilder has wrote about this years ago, but I still think it's probably one of the greatest examples of just how dumb ideas are that are brilliant ideas, is in when I was a kid, television was broadcast from transmitting antennas through the air to an antenna on top of my television receiver in my living room. Okay? Television was wireless. And somebody came along and said, hey, I've got a great idea. Let's build from scratch an entirely new coaxial network that will be a cable going to every single household in the entire country, and we can send the television signals by wire. That is a really stupid idea, which of course is what we have today. Now, at the same time as this is happening, I also, when I was a kid growing up, there was a telephone in a niche in the wall in the hallway of my house, and it connected to a wire that went out and went down to the central office. And somebody came along and said, hey, I've got a great idea. Let's take telephony off the wires and put it in the air. What we'll do is we'll build 300-foot tall antennas every 3 miles along the entire, United States. And this will be great. This will work. This is a really ridiculous and stupid idea. So what I'm trying to get across to you is the magnitude of stupidity is equivalent to the magnitude of the innovation and the creativity and the potential for these ideas. So when somebody comes up to you with a crazy idea, you have to be really careful because all the really good ones look stupid. The conundrum, of course, is that the really bad ones look stupid too. So. So I was giving a talk one day at Stanford University, and Terry Winograd, who's the head of the CS department, took me into a graduate seminar that was going on at the time, and he introduced me to a couple of guys. He said, these guys are working on a new search algorithm that I looked at him and I said, good luck, that's a soda market, there's nothing there for you. No, Sir David, Larry Page. So in this long history of me, I mean, I'm guilty of this too. I like to think, you know, I pat myself on the back. I've invented some pretty cool stuff in my day, but also, I told these guys they were going down a rabbit hole. In 1976, when I bought my first computer, I was talking with my friend Mitchell Wade, and he had an Apple I in his office, and he also had an IMSA 8080, and this was one of the first S100 computers, and the Apple I at that time was just a printed circuit board, and he had the printed circuit board sitting on a stack of textbooks in the corner of his office playing Brinca. And he goes, this Apple is going to rule. And I go, Mitch, that's really stupid. And I own one of these. I'm just saying, you guys all remember the inside of it. So it's really easy to get this stuff wrong. So Linus Pauling, a famous scientist, said, the way to have good ideas is to have a lot of ideas. And this is true, okay? But what it means, you see, the implications of this go over the heads of people who have to actually deal with this, because what it means is that if you have good ideas, it means you're also up to here in bad ideas. Okay, and then while it's daunting to identify the good ideas and develop them and nurture them, it's equally daunting to deal with all those bad ideas that are clogging up your world. Because how do you know it's a bad idea? I mean, this is the thing, is they don't come up to you and say, hi, I'm a bad idea, throw me out. You know, they come up to you and they say, I'm stupid and weird. And then, you know, Google walks up to you and says, hi, I'm stupid and weird. And so how do you know? Well, how do you know when a person is a nice person or not?
You get to know them.
Right, exactly. You get to know them. It takes time. It takes time. And that's the only way. So what it means you have to do is you have to spend time with people to get to know them, to know if they're good or bad. Then you have to spend time with your ideas to know if they're good or bad. And business people hate that shit. I didn't mean to say that. The thing is that we are living in a culture of success. Okay, we worship success in our world. Okay, and what that means is when the boss says, okay, we've got to fail fast, what he means is, don't you dare fail. And I'm not interested in your failures. Your failures are going to be a black mark against you and your permanent record. And this is difficult. So you get this problem in creative organizations where the only way to deal with a bad idea is to let the team that had it ride it like a lame horse until it dies. And then they go, well, that didn't work. And then they come back and they say, okay, let's try something different. No fault, no foul, no blame, you know. But if you go in and you go, I'm the big boss here, I've got more experience than you do, and I can tell you that's a lame horse, stop it. What you've done is you've just killed the motivation, the morale of that team. And the thing is it's more expensive to your organization to blunt the morale of the team than it is for you to finance them to spend a few more weeks of riding the lame horse. Okay, so that's a tough job. So in the environment we're in is a business environment, you know, and business is by definition a machine for not doing stupid things. What business is all about is about analyzing the lay of the land, finding the opportunities that look like they have the most promise, and putting all the investment behind those. and identifying the things that look really dumb and not doing them. So this is why you wrangle constantly with your boss. Or if you are the boss, this is why you're constantly under financial pressure that's stopping you from doing the kind of innovation that you know you need to do. Have you read Ed Catmull's book, Creativity Inc.? It's a neat book. He is the one of the founders of Pixar. And so talk about stupid ideas, you know, toys that have a personality and, you know, searching for a fish or little creatures inside the head of a 13-year-old girl. These are stupid ideas. And he knows it. He knows that their stock and trade is stupid ideas. So they've learned over the years that they just suspend disbelief. And when somebody brings forth a stupid idea, in fact, if somebody brought forth a brilliant idea, they're going to stipulate that it's stupid anyway and work from that point of view. And they're going to say, we're not going to make any value judgment. We're just going to develop it until we see if there's there and there. This is a very interesting methodology. I think it's one that really is applicable for what we do. So, but this, if you get an MBA, this is what they teach you, how not to do stupid things. And this is why I say management is dead, long live management. Because pretty much everything we know about management is not helping us anymore. You know, it turns out, sure, being fiscally responsible, that's a good thing. And I'm not saying it shouldn't be. I'm not saying piss off money or you know, do that Wall Street kind of craziness. I'm not saying that. But what I'm saying is that that you when you look at the investment into a product that you make as an innovation organization, and then you compare it to the return you get, there's no relationship. So you can go to Stanford University, you can go to the William H. Gates III in computer science building, and down in the basement, there's little windows along the wall. And in one of those little windows is Google's first server. It's made out of Legos. I think you find a picture of it. So how much did they pay to get that server up and running? Was it $50,000? I mean, to get the company going with the server and to get their algorithms working? And they turned it into the largest, most successful company on the face of the planet. Okay, so would it have mattered if they'd spent $500,000? It's a rounding error. Would it have mattered if it cost them $5 million? I don't understand venture capitalists, frankly. That's just a little aside. So, because I would just do things differently, especially with other people's money. So, management, of course, this is a beautiful Scotland photo. Management, of course, is the art of doing the stupid without remaining stupid. There's not a business person. Business people have a lot of dignity, you know, and no business person would ever admit that. I, however, become pretty embarrassed. So it doesn't matter. I told Larry Page he was going wrong. So the thing to do is to create that kind of nurturing environment. This is about, now it's time for a commercial by Company Cooper. This is what we do. We're really good at helping management to do this kind of stuff. And there are three elements, I think, to managing in an innovative world. And this is what we try to help business people do, is focus, empower, and aim high. And it's focus is, in many ways, the simplest and the most difficult. You know, it's like, can't we all just get along? Everybody needs to know what you're trying to accomplish as an organization, as a group. And that's really hard because everybody goes winding off into their little arenas, their little areas of work, and they get lost in the details, they get confused, and they fall back on old tropes, especially if they, you know, somebody comes along and says, how much is that going to cost? All of a sudden they think, oh, my job here is to not spend a lot of money. Whereas what your job is to innovate and create the life. So it's the executive's number one job to make sure that everybody knows who their target user market is and what they're trying to accomplish and how they measure success. Okay? And this is the boss's job, is to come around every day and say, what are we doing? Why are we doing it? Who are we doing it for? Words to that effect. Because it's so easy for people to get lost, to get confused. And every single high-tech company in Silicon Valley has, you know, lots of highly paid, highly educated, self-motivated, hardworking people slaving away at their computers doing cool stuff. Okay? Which I have done for the last 40 years, and I can tell you there's no greater distraction than doing that. Your work itself is a distraction, so you need somebody to be constantly telling you why you're doing that work. I'm not a very good boss. I don't do this with people at Cooper. I ask other people who are much better at communicating to do that, because I'm a geek, and I go back to my desk, and I get lost in my stuff, and people forget what it is they're doing. It's a really hard job, and it's not something that comes natural to the quote-unquote business type person. You know. Empower is the easiest of the bunch. It's whenever your team has an issue, you make it go away. They don't have enough time, you give them more time. They don't have enough money, you give them more money. Their chairs aren't any good, you give them better chairs. They need a stand-up desk, you give them a stand-up desk. They ask for a more powerful computer, you give them more powerful computer. Okay? They need access to users to be able to interview them. They need to fly to Singapore to talk to people, fly them to Singapore, give them access to the users. They need to talk to the CEO to find out what the hell the company wants to do. Let them talk to the CEO. That's the business person's job, is to empower the team. A few. And you guys have heard of Daniel Pink's three motivations. Mastery was autonomy, mastery, and purpose. And this notion of aim high, I mean, in the world of traditional business, is I work hard because I get paid hard, and I get perquisites, and I get power, and I get that corner office. This is the business motivations. But most geeks, most technologists, most practitioners are motivated for that stuff. What we like to do is we like to accomplish something. I vanquished this language. I figured out how to make this library dance. Okay, that's mastery. I did it myself. It's autonomy. And I've learned from this. And purpose is the same as aim high, which is I don't want to do this so that the company makes more money. I don't really care about what the board of directors is thinking. I want to know, am I making a better world? Because that's what motivates me. And so your job as a business person is not to say, okay, we're going to do something here because it will make money, and then we'll rank ourselves on how much money we make. You have to say, we're going to do something because it's the right thing to do. We're taking responsibility to create a better world. And that's something that is you have to provide that these days. Otherwise, you're not going to get anywhere. You have to ask yourself, am I being a good ancestor? You have to, this is aim high. Is what I'm doing leaving this world a better place? So it should be delightful. If you're going to delight your users, you should be delighted. You should be having fun. And if you find that sitting at your desk and trying to figure out CSS or Ruby or whatever you're struggling with is making you crazy, you should try farming. You should get your hands in the dirt. It's delightful. It's really satisfying. And it's very, yes, my tongue is in my cheek, but it's true. It's, we get lost. Matthew Crawford wrote a fabulous book a few years ago called he talks about being told, well, you can do manual labor, you can do craft. If you like to work on motorcycles, you can do that. But if you want something really satisfying, you need to work in an office. So he got a job working in a stockbroker's office in Boston. And he found it just mind-numbing, and he quit. He started a motorcycle repair business, and he wrote a book about it. And it's a myth that office work is more morally, emotionally, mentally, physically satisfying than working with your hands in the dirt. That's just a commercial part. Apropos of nothing. Okay, so but I know you guys are having fun, right? Yeah, see, you gotta have fun. I mean, if you can't laugh at yourself, it means somebody else is laughing, right? Okay, so this brings us back to Kono Bosego. It means Kono Bosego, management is changing. And all that exercise of power and authority and perquisites and you know, the trappings of leadership, that's all. That's a swimming pool. It's got to go. You know, I'm so happy that I'm a practitioner and not a manager, because the practitioner's job is just practice and be a good ancestor. But the job of a manager is you have to throw out everything you learned and start from scratch. That's tough. A Kono Bosego means that developing ideas is managing failure. That's the hard part. How do you let go without tears? It's a real challenge. It's really difficult. And a Kono Bosego means a willingness to accept stupid and to cherish stupid and roll with it and not judge and watch as sometimes the stupid plays out into brilliance and sometimes not. And you've got to go, well, let's have a drink and move on. Or as Susan Gibbs says, failure is a drinking opportunity. And Kono Bosego, of course, means be a good ancestor. Reassess your goals. What are you trying to do in this world? You know, are you trying to build good software, or are you trying to change the world? Are you trying to put a dent in the universe? The interesting thing, I think, is that there are people with money who are powerful, and there are people with authority who are powerful, and then there's us practitioners who labor in the trenches every day. But what's really interesting is that we are the most powerful because we have our hands on the levers of everything that's done in this world today. We're the keystone in the arch, and without us, all the money and all the management, all the business talent out there means nothing. And we have not been in that position. We're unfamiliar with that position. We don't think in those terms. We kind of go, okay, my job is just to make the thing that my boss tells me to make. But really, our job is to step up and take responsibility and say, is this the right thing for us to make? I mean, look at the disruptive economics that's going on, where a company like Uber, which is a wonderful company, came in and took a truly terrible industry, the taxi industry, which if any industry needed a swift kick in the ass, it was the taxi industry. And Uber delivered with bells on, thank you. But But Uber's not a taxi company. Okay, so they don't have a, they don't own cars, they don't have paid staff, they don't have meters in cars. So from a regulatory point of view, Uber is not regarded as a taxi company. When you and I get an Uber, it's just like getting a taxi, it feels the same. But from a regulatory point of view, there's no protections. Our government has no regulatory edifice in place to protect us from predatory behavior on the part of Uber. Now, I'm not saying Uber is behaving in a predatory way, but what I'm saying is, once all the taxi cab companies are out of business and we're all dependent on Uber, what's to stop them? They have done this with our labor. It's our responsibility to say, we need to think this stuff through, we need to take some action. I don't know how to do that. That's kind of my current project, is figuring that out. How do we take responsibility? But I've arrived at the first point, is that practice is about taking responsibility to be a good ancestor. Our children are going to face whatever Uber becomes. So it's up to us to make sure that it becomes the right thing. And thank you. That's my talk for today.
Finance, we all have access to the same finance.
Okay, there's no strategic advantage to market because we're all going through the same marketing channels. Okay, what's strategic? It's how we behave as a company. And how you behave as a company is with your technology, with your products, with the behavior of your software and our tech. And we're the ones who build it. And there's every day there's hundreds of decisions. Hold the people around you, hold them accountable to, hold their feet to the fire, make them aware. It's just, it starts as water cooler talk. And eventually it becomes a movement. I mean, it does. It sounds stupid, doesn't it? Another question. This young man.
Great talk, Alan. I regard you as one of the interaction designer pioneer, and I have a question as a practitioner in the same area. If I'm coming up with a crazy, let's say, new way, novel way of having an interaction in a mobile app, but and I'm, maybe it's a stupid idea, but I see the novelty. I